In 2016, scientists discovered a species of bacteria that is able to break down PET plastic. This is a phenomenal feat because the bonds that make up plastic are notoriously difficult to break. Plastic left to decay in a landfill is projected to take hundreds of years to break down. If you want to know more about PET and the future of recycling this material, you should check out this video by our chemist collaborator, Lumi at the Benchtop. However, in this video, we will discuss the evolution of this plastic degrading superpower. In 2016, when this bacteria, Eidanella sakiensis, was discovered, plastic had only been around for about 100 years. So how did this plastic degrading superpower evolve so fast? Before we get into that, let me give you a brief history on plastics. Plastic was first invented in 1869 as a cheaper substitute for ivory. This early plastic contained cellulose from plants, so the first fully synthetic plastic, a material known as bakelite, was invented in 1907. Plastics were valued and praised during the early part of the 20th century because they cut down the use of more expensive natural compounds. And they allowed products that were once considered to be uncommon luxuries to become affordable. And you can see this for yourself in this 1957 promotional video.
Well, these are all examples of what we mean when we say chemistry is at work in conservation. Chipboard, what is it? But ingenuity plus plastics. The very word plastics takes us right into the heart of conservation, because plastics improve on the products of nature, and thus take the pressure off our natural resources.
But attitudes towards plastic began to change in the 1960s when plastic became associated with cheap and low-quality products. A decade later, in the 1970s, plastic's reputation took an even bigger nosedive when we realized the detrimental effects of this material on the environment, leading plastic to become a symbol of wastefulness and excess. While plastic has only been around for about a century, PET has been around for an even shorter amount of time. This material, while patented about 80 years ago, only came into widespread use in the 1970s. So how did this PET digesting enzyme, aptly known as PEGase, come to be in such a short amount of time? Well, it didn't exactly evolve from scratch. Instead, nature tinkered with existing enzymes to generate this new function. Let me explain. Enzymes can have side hustles, jobs that aren't their usual job with their usual clients. And they tend to be less proficient at these jobs. They don't do them as often and are kind of slow at it, but nonetheless, they can get the job done. A scientific take on these enzyme side hustles would term them promiscuous, meaning that they've caught their usual clients, also called ligands, but they could really do their job for anyone. Many enzymes are promiscuous. If you've seen our video, Belladonna, A Tale of Two Ligands, then you know what I'm talking about. But it's usually more than two ligands. In fact, scientists found that from 217 members of one enzyme superfamily, the haloalkanate dehalogenase family, the median number of ligands, or clients, these enzymes could catalyze was 15. There was even one enzyme that could catalyze 143 ligands. Basically, most enzymes can do a lot of jobs. So the one enzyme, one ligand you learn in textbooks is not the full story. Okay, so enzymes can do lots of jobs, but what does this have to do with Eidanella sakiensis and its novel plastic eating ability? Well, these promiscuous activities can serve as the tinkering points for evolution. Since they're not the enzyme's primary job, they can afford to play around and find out what works best, without sacrificing a critical function. So innovating new functions is relatively easy. What's tricky is optimizing. Optimizing to find its niche function, finding what reaction it catalyzes best. Back to PEGase. This is not the first enzyme that we've discovered that can break down PET. We have known about a few different enzymes from bacteria and fungi that can also do this. What made the discovery of PEGase novel is that it's the first enzyme where PET is the preferred substrate. It's its main job. It is not its side hustle. PEGase optimized this function specifically. On top of that, the bacteria that produces PEGase uses PET as its primary carbon source. It actually uses the plastic as food. Scientists believe PEGase is part of the hydrolase family of enzymes, specifically the ones that break ester bonds. The ancestors of this family typically break bonds in cutin, a waxy substance that coats the leaves of many plants to prevent them from losing too much water. So this new function didn't exactly come from nowhere. The enzyme got repurposed from plant invader to plastic destroyer. So in the process of breaking down PET bonds, you have two main players. You have PETase and MHETase. First, PETase is secreted by the bacteria and begins converting PET into mono-2-hydroxylethyl terephthalate, or more easily, MHET. Then MHETase comes in and digests MHET into ethylene glycol and terephthalic acid, which then the bacteria can use to generate energy for itself. So before you start thinking that this enzyme is going to save the world, don't. Or at least not yet. While degradation by PETase is much faster than letting PET degrade on its own, it's no miracle, and it still takes a really long time. But there are options for improvement. For example, one of the reasons why the enzyme works so slowly is because the bonds it needs to reach are tightly woven in the plastic structure. If we could stabilize PETase to work at high temperatures, we'd be able to heat the plastic, expose the bonds, and then increase the degradation rate. Another avenue for improvement is attaching PETase and MHETase together to have them work side by side, making their function more like an assembly line, where you don't have to send your product down to another factory to have it finished. So those were just two examples of how to optimize this process through enzyme engineering. And engineering a more optimal enzyme is absolutely possible. Serendipitously, a team of scientists working to make PETase less efficient accidentally made it more efficient. I know that sounds weird, but they were trying to mutate the protein to look more like its possible cutinase ancestor to investigate its evolutionary past. And voila, their mutant turned out to like PET even more than before. It just goes to show you that sometimes your hypotheses can be wrong in an excellent way. Amidst all the worry about how plastic use is affecting the environment, it's good to know that there are options for improvement. And if the independent evolution of PETase has taught us anything, it's that nature will find a way. Whether or not we will be there to find out.